The Lockheed XFV-1 was an American experimental vertical takeoff and landing aircraft developed in the late 1940s. It was the result of a request for proposals issued by the U.S. Army and Navy shortly after World War II had ended. The military had a new need for an airplane capable of vertical takeoff and landing without runways or landing platforms. Initially, the planes were intended to be launched from the sea to protect ship convoys. However, the logic behind such a proposal soon evolved following the generalized idea that a nuclear war between the U.S. and the Soviet Union was inevitable. And when the time came, the only possible way the U.S. could win would be by overwhelming its enemy with a lethal air force. Since aircraft were the primary vehicles used for carrying and dropping bomb loads, including nuclear weaponry, the U.S. expected that the first targets attacked by the Russians would be airfields across the world. The VTOL, or Vertical Takeoff and Landing Project, was born with the objective of launching aircraft from any place across the world. With that in mind, Lockheed and Convair came up with two similar airplane designs that successfully took off and landed vertically. However, the catch was the difficulty to master the flight controls, as the aircraft proved to be unstable and unreliable when it came to shifting from horizontal to vertical positions. With the Cold War's arms race and technological innovations improving as every day passed, the VTOL project was quickly left behind and cancelled in 1955. By then, jet fighters that could surpass Mach 1 and Mach 2 speeds demonstrated that they would instead be the future of military aviation. Nuclear menace. When World War II ended, Europe was utterly shattered and broken. For the first time in more than 2,000 years, a non-European country became the global economic power. Power now rested in the hands of the U.S., thanks to its emerging relatively unscathed from the conflict and its temporary monopoly over atomic power. Millions of people were left baffled and terrorized by the nuclear bombs that destroyed Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945. America thought it would take time for the Russians to figure out how to develop the nuclear weapons that the U.S. had at its disposal. Still, the Russians captured German scientists and gathered valuable intel regarding the latest German military innovations before the war ended. The day came sooner than expected. On August 29, 1949, at the Semipalatinsk test site in Kazakhstan, the Soviets detonated their first nuclear bomb. The world was left in awe. Only 4 years had passed since the U.S. had dropped the two atomic bombs on Japan. The arms race between the U.S. and the Soviet Union had formally begun. The doctrine of mutually assured destruction prompted both nations to stockpile a nuclear arsenal that had the capabilities of completely obliterating humankind from the face of the earth. The U.S. and the Soviet Union knew that World War III would begin the same way World War II had ended: nuclear weaponry. Vertical takeoff and landing. The U.S. military planned various ways to stay in the fight and win a nuclear war after the first enemy nukes had made landfall. One way was the concept of VTOL, or vertical takeoff and landing aircraft. World War II had taught the U.S. that aviation was the backbone of any military operation. Landing strips popped up in every war theater. In Europe, the Pacific, Africa, and Asia, airfields were constructed everywhere for supplies to ship in and bring reinforcements. These airstrips throughout the world would be seen as an imposing threat to the Soviets in a new conflict, as they would give the U.S. and its allies the upper edge to launch armed-to-the-teeth payload bombers deep into Soviet territory. U.S. intelligence officials believed that airstrips would be the first targets of a Soviet nuclear attack if World War III ever happened. If that occurred, the U.S. would have to figure out what to do to gain the upper edge against the communist enemy. The conclusion was that the U.S. Air Force needed a new fighter that could take off and land without the need for a well-made runway. Already in 1947, the new U.S. Air Force and the U.S. Navy had sponsored Project Hummingbird, a military and scientific study of VTOL technology. Goals that came out of the program, according to the National Air and Space Museum, included to, quote, develop an aircraft that could take off and land vertically on destroyers, LSTs, fleet oilers, transports, and larger ships not otherwise equipped to handle conventional aircraft. In theory, a VTOL fighter could protect the mothership or join other VTOL fighters to defend a task force or convoy. Project Hummingbird produced a VTOL model that proved the idea could succeed. The prototype had a standard airplane fuselage, a cruciform tail, which functioned as the landing gear, and contra-rotating propellers. Additional lessons from the Focke-Wulf-Triebflugel thrust wing program were incorporated. By 1949, the U.S. Air Force brought in the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, known as NACA, to further study the physical and mechanical possibilities of aircraft that could take off vertically. Just like in Hummingbird, the aim was that the airplane could take off and land vertically and shift into horizontal flight once in the air. It was also to land vertically after its flight. Deployment in the aftermath of a nuclear strike was now top of mind. Lockheed XFV. In 1951, Lockheed and Convair were awarded two contracts to develop similar aircraft. Two prototypes were ordered from Lockheed under the designation XFV-1. The design was not aesthetically pleasing. It had an awkward look that made it appear like a helicopter blended with a fighter aircraft whose nose pointed directly to the sky, but it was functional. Aviation pioneer Kelly Johnson was the brain behind Lockheed's VTOL design. Johnson had just come off from developing the P-38 Lightning and the USAF's first jet, the P-80 Shooting Star, when he was contacted by the company to work on the VTOL program. As an aeronautical engineer, his successful career would lead him to oversee legendary aircraft of the Cold War, like the U-2 spy plane, the SR-71 Blackbird, and the F-117 Nighthawk. The XFV-1 had a short fuselage with tapered broad-cord short-span wings with pods at the extreme tips. The aircraft sat on the runway completely vertical, resting on a reinforced X-shaped tail with various wheels. The aircraft had a length and height of 36 feet and a wingspan of 30 feet. The XFV had a gross weight of 16,221 pounds, if equipped with four 20mm cannons. The pilot sat underneath the cockpit, which was located towards the rear of the fuselage. Entry and exit from the cockpit required a unique ladder. The vertical position of the aircraft made it hard to board quickly. The XFV was powered by a 5,332-horsepower Allison YT-40 A6 turboprop engine driving three-bladed contra-rotating propellers. At takeoff, the engines ran up to full power, and the aircraft ascended vertically. After reaching a safe altitude, the plane would shift to a standard horizontal flight, just like any other airplane. For landing, the aircraft would approach the landing pad pitched up into a nose-high position. Then it would gradually descend to the ground at slow speed. Performance and testing. A quarter-scale wind tunnel model, powered by two 38-horsepower electric motors, was constructed to test the prototype. It did well, although there were some minor problems regarding aircraft control when it tried to shift from vertical to horizontal positions at high speeds. Different test cockpits were built to analyze other control methods and test the rotating reclining seat that moved between vertical and horizontal orientations. The first XFV prototype was ready in mid-1953. It went straight to Edwards Air Force Base in October 1953. In December of that same year, the XFV-1 would fly for the first time under the expertise of Chief Test Pilot Herman Fish Salmon. The Lockheed XFV would actually get its nickname, Salmon, after an unintentional success during the airplane's testing. Herman Fish Salmon was an aviation icon of his time. By age 18, he was already a licensed pilot. By the 1940s, he had already flown a long career as a barnstormer, parachute stuntman, and race pilot. If there was one man that could make a VTOL fly vertically for the first time in history, it was him. And he precisely did so, by accident. During horizontal taxi tests, Salmon applied too much power and made the aircraft hot briefly. Less than a year later, in June 1954, Salmon would take the plane all the way into the sky for its first real flight. During the 35-minute flight that reached 10,000 feet, initial positive impressions turned grim quickly. Although the XFV was able to take off vertically, the aircraft was underpowered and unreliable for vertical landings. It was difficult to control between 30 and 80 degrees at lower speeds, even for veteran pilots like Salmon himself. Results showed that the Allison YT-40 A6 turboprop engine installed was not powerful enough for vertical takeoffs and landings. Lockheed planned to use the more powerful Allison T-54 engine, which would produce 7,100 horsepower, but development problems ensured it never saw the light. The prototype XFV-1 made a total of 32 flights and managed to hover with its nose up for a short period of time, but it never accomplished a complete vertical takeoff or landing. By 1954, the XFV was left behind by jet aircraft, which were nearing speeds of Mach 2, while the VTOL prototypes could barely get up to 700 miles per hour. It didn't help that the airplane's awful handling meant that only the most experienced pilots could fly it. The VTOL project was canceled on June 16, 1955. The Condor project was also scrapped 6 weeks later, on August 1st, 1955. the future of VTOLs. Had the project been seen through, the proposed production version of the Lockheed XFV was to be designated FV2, and it was going to be powered by the T-54A16 turboprop engine. Additional features included a bulletproof windshield, armor for combat, and radar in the fixed forward part of the nose spinner. The weaponry attached to this model would have been composed of four 20mm cannons fitted into two wingtip pods, or two 3/4-inch folding fin rockets for a more explosive arsenal. The surviving prototype was sent to the Sun and Fun Campus Museum at Lakeland Linder International Airport in Lakeland, Florida. It was later refurbished at the museum's Bueller Restoration Center, where it can be appreciated today with a timeless look. The second prototype, which Lockheed never completed, is also on display at Los Alamitos Army Airfield, California.